Last Days Church, Pastor Jacob. Sorry, guys, it's a little warm in here. We're having some problems with the ACs. You know, the enemy just comes out of the woodwork at a time where you're not expecting it. And so maybe we should just always expect hell to move, because we always want heaven moving, right? So that means hell's always responding. But we've been so busy doing stuff around this building. And I tell you, there's been some incredible stuff that's happened this week. And I don't mean physical. I don't mean physical construction, but spiritually. There's been changes in lives. There's been healing. There's been fellowship. A greater love for Jesus. A greater love for his body. And no matter what kind of changes takes place in the building, may we never be distracted from Jesus. You know, I know some of you might have walked in and go, oh my gosh, they sold out. They've become one of those churches. Where's the camera and the rails and up front? And are we going to start throwing handkerchiefs? No, we're not doing that. And there's a few that were pleasantly honest enough with me, two people that were like, I don't know, because of that concern. See, what happens is, because of professional religion that takes place, and the emphasis is not on Jesus, and it's not on the presence of the Holy Spirit, we overemphasize the physical things. And I just want you to know, in Jesus' name, that ain't going to happen here. Amen? See, when you read your Bible and you read stories like Nehemiah, and you read stories where they go to rebuild the temple or rebuild the walls, and there was something spiritual significant that was supposed to take place, because the temple would just be torn down again and the walls would be torn down, and as a matter of fact, everything in this world is going to be nuked from heaven, and God's going to make a whole new earth. So one could say, what's the whole point of building the temple when it's going to be torn down and even taking care of anything? Because we see God in those acts of obedience and sacrifice, where we come together and we make it about God's plan and not our plan. And there's a death that comes and a life that follows. That's what's supposed to take place. I was praying this morning. I'm like, Lord, so how are we starting this whole thing off, Lord, as we go through Revelation chapter 1, 2, and 3, and look at the Last Days Church? You see, I've been praying for the last 6 months and about something. I'm like, Lord, what's going on with your body? Where are we? How do you feel about where we're at? See, that matters to me. I hope it matters to you. I hope you care how Jesus feels. He looked over at Israel and he wept. We know how he felt. In Revelation chapter 2 and 3, he writes letters to these seven churches in Asia Minor because he wants to tell them what he sees and what blesses him and what grieves him. And one of the great things about God is not only will he come and encourage and rebuke, he will come and counsel and encourage as well. My prayer is that over the next 3 months, as we go through these three chapters, that God would give revelation to us, that he would instruct us as his body, and he would tell us what blesses him. What grieves him? That we would have an ear to hear what the Spirit would say to the church, and we would go, Lord, counsel me. Encourage me, Holy Spirit. We're desperate for you. Are you desperate for him? We can't do it without him. You know, we try, don't we? Boy, we try. Just like a little boy tries to put together his first bicycle, and his daddy looks at him and says, okay, go ahead, give it a shot. And we know he's not going to be able to do it, but it's okay. And he gets to that place where he says, I really want to ride this thing, but I'm incapable of constructing it. That's what Abba Father is like. He says, you want to try it on your own? Okay. Israel did that with a king by the name of Saul. It didn't work out too well. We don't do it with a king. We just do it with organized religion. That's what we do. And he sits back and he waits for us to go, we tried to put this thing together, Dad, but it's a mess. And those that are willing to humble themselves and say, Father, help. Matter of fact, I just surrender the whole thing to you. A church experiences revival. See, this incredible book, Revelation, it speaks of Jesus. There you go. Now you know the book of Revelation. I've heard people go, I want to go through the book of Revelations. It's the book of Revelation. Jesus, it's all about him. See, the Gospels, they spend an incredible amount of focus on talking about Jesus, the Lamb. Of course, Matthew talks about him as a king, and we know, Bible students here, you understand those different aspects of Christ, but it speaks of him as a man. And see, the book of Revelation speaks of him as the Lion, speaks of him as the glorified Christ. Do you know him as the glorified Christ? And even what does that mean, you might ask? This book starts off, Revelation chapter 1. It says, the revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show his servants, that would be those in this place today that love Jesus, to show his servants things which must shortly take place. And he sent and signified, or brought it with signs, by his angel to his servant John. He bore witness to the word of God and to the testimony of Jesus Christ, to all things that he saw. Blessed is he who reads and those who hear the words of this prophecy, and to keep those things which are written in it, for the time is near. Stop there. Now that's the way to start off a book. The revealing of Jesus Christ. And it says there's a need for a revealing or an unveiling of who Jesus is. And I'm just going to go right for the jugular. You ready? Because the time is near. Now, we could pull these verses apart and look at this Greek word and that Greek word. Instead, I'm just going to go ahead, instead of coming at you as a theologian, which I'm not one to begin with, or trying to, I should say, I'll just come to you with childlike faith and say, Jesus is reaching out to his body because he wants us to know things. He wants us to know stuff about him and what he's doing. And he wants us to know as his servants that he's coming back and he's coming back soon. And he says he wants us to be blessed, verse 3. I want to be blessed. Hallelujah. Anybody want a blessing today? I want a blessing. I want to be blissful. That's what it really means. I want to be blissful, God. And it says, blessed are blissful those who reads and hears the words in this book. Do you know this book comes with a promise of bliss? That's enough to see. A lot of people read the book of Revelation, or they attempt to, and they go, ooh, I don't know about the book of Revelation. Give me John 14 or John 3:16 or something, and I can dig that. But Revelation, that's just too much. Too much signified words in there is verse 2. So I just can't do that. I need the revelation of Jesus Christ is simple, and yet it's completely profound, mysterious. Oh, without the Holy Spirit, we're clueless to understand any of it. So, good news. If you're here today and you're a servant of the Lord, know this letter is for you. If you love Jesus and the Spirit of the living God lives in you, God wants to talk to you through this letter. And he wants to equip you to deal with some hard times that you're going through and some hard times that are coming. See, when I was born again, I remember back in 1984, one of the things that I would always hear is, Jesus is coming soon, right? And then I would hear some skeptics go, oh, I've been hearing that for years. And I would just go, wow, they need to get saved. And then as I got involved in the church and the body of Christ, I started seeing people that were saved that all of a sudden were becoming complacent, like they weren't thinking that Jesus was coming back soon anymore. And they would argue eschatological points, you know, your pre-wrath, your post, and they'd get on this doctrine. In other words, they'd get way too impressed with themselves to have a childlike faith to go, what is your letter saying to me? Our own heads get in our way many times. Do you know this? And you've heard me say it before, many Christians are like that theological porcupine, many fine points, but you can't get close to them. That's the way they are reading Bible verses. And they want to argue over, you ready? A love letter. How insane is that? I don't want to argue over a love letter from God. I want to know. I've got a dad who I just read wants to show me things. And he says he's coming back. And he wants, and it's important, it's paramount that I know these things. You see, in Luke, I believe it was chapter 18, Jesus posed a question, and I'll read it. He says, when the Son of Man comes, will he really find faith in the earth? Now, we know from Laodicea, he's knocking on the door to the Moose Lodge, to the White House. He's going to knock that door down, Jesus' name. But he's actually knocking on the door to the church, right? Because they're trying to build the bicycle by themselves, and they can't do it. You see, in verse 4, it says, John, to the seven churches which are in Asia, or Turkey. He's writing to the churches, and he's trying to get a message to them. And as we go through these seven churches, we're going to go, Ephesus. Yeah, it's this church that had this first love flame. They fell in love with Jesus, but then they got caught up in building their own monument. And some Christians are like that. Others are like those in Smyrna. They're just crushed, but there's just this beautiful fragrance that's giving off. Other Christians are like the church of Pergamos, where they're polygamists. They've got all kinds of winds of doctrine. It's just confusing them, going left and right. Others are like the Church of Philadelphia. Don't you know that, man, they really love God and they love each other. And there's those, Laodicea, are the rule of the people, what that means, which they just, it's basically bureaucracy and bulletins and denominational dogma of certain doctrines has blocked out what God wants to do. Right? I don't know if you noticed, but if you walked in the lobby or the right side, you might have noticed a clock that was there with no hands on it. Uh-huh. Do you get it? See, as we get together, it's not the rule of the people. It's not the rule of our agenda or what we want. It's supposed to be, Lord, we're here to serve you. See, the body doesn't tell the head what to do. The head is supposed to tell us what to do, right? That's what's supposed to take place. And see, all these churches were mixed up. And in the last days, Jesus knew. He prophesied, gave a spirit of prophecy through the Apostle Paul when he was writing to Timothy concerning the church in the last days. I don't know if you've noticed, but the church in the last days is hurting right now. And we talked about this last month, about the 1,700 pastors a month in this country that are leaving the pulpit. That's heartbreaking and scary. I feel like I'm walking on landmines with my calling, honestly. And we see all these churches closing, and we see an increase of liberal thinking and New Age thinking and tolerance and persecution of the church. It used to be very much so just in third world countries, but it's the net's closing in, as we see. It really is. Big time, more than we realize. This is happening, and I'm convinced that it's all part of the stage being set for his coming. He's coming. Hallelujah. He's coming. I can't wait to see him. I can't wait to see Jesus. I can't wait to see his bloodstained eyes. I can't wait to see him who is disfigured beyond the recognition of a man in glory. And so when I see these things going on around me with the church, I go, oh, Lord, it's part of what you foretold. Through the book of Jude, the apostate church that we're going to see take place. And he writes through the Apostle Paul to Timothy. Listen closely to what he said about some things. It says in 2 Timothy 3, it says, but you know this, that in the last days perilous times will come, for men will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, unloving, unforgiving, slanderous, without self-control, brutal, despisers of good, traitors, headstrong, haughty, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having a form of godliness, but denying its power, from such people, turn away. Now, see, you read all these things, it talks about the last days church, what would take place. And it says that I believe this is an organized religion. This is going to have a form of godliness, but not denying the power. In other words, we're going to have religion, but not a relationship with God. We're going to have knowledge, but not a passion for God. We're going to have entrepreneur spirits and intellect and natural giftings, but we're going to lack the power and anointing of the Holy Spirit. That's what we're reading here, I believe. And that's what we see happening widespread in the church. But see, this is what happens, is it takes place so subtly over the years that we get used to it. I mean, like, for example, you know, we get used to a sound system and we go, man, that person's voice and that drum and that piano, oh, it sounds so beautiful. And it moves us to the point where sometimes we think that's the Holy Spirit that we're being moved. It's not necessarily the Holy Spirit, you know? I mean, Judas was a wreck. He was a mess emotionally. And you know what? He wasn't necessarily walking in an anointing. People are full of joy and laughing, but they're not full of the Holy Spirit. They might be full of a different spirit, if you know what I mean, right? So we can see counterfeits that take place. In other words, it looks like we're walking with Jesus as his body, but it's only a form of godliness. It's a counterfeit form. And in the last days, the church is going to be full of this stuff going on, so much so it's hard to tell the difference. And so for those that care enough to know about a difference, this letter is written, a revealing of Jesus. I love what the Amplified Bible, you don't have to turn there if you have an Amplified Bible, and you don't need to put that up on the screen, but listen to this verse here in the Amplified Bible in Revelation. It says, this is the revelation of Jesus Christ, his unveiling of the divine mysteries. God gave it to him to disclose and make known to his bondservant certain things which must shortly and speedily come to pass in their entirety. Man, I like that. Divine mysteries? I want revelation. I need revelation from God. The Apostle Paul praying for the Ephesians, he was praying, he says, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in knowledge of him. Paul was praying for the church. He was like, I'm praying God gives you a spirit of revelation, a removing of a veil, the divine mysteries, things that you could not possibly understand, that there would be a knowledge that goes beyond intellectual perception. Because, see, if it's just knowledge, see, I knew Jesus was the Messiah and was a Savior while I was smoking dope when I was 17 years old. I believed it. But it was just an intellectual knowledge that I had heard, what I had learned. But it wasn't a spiritual knowledge. It wasn't revelation from God. That's why there was no fruit, you see. We need not, because if you have that kind of knowledge, spiritual knowledge, you have power that goes right along with it. That spiritual revelation and that true power from God are synonymous. They just go parallel. They run with each other. We are in desperate need of that today with the church. And it begins with knowing who Jesus is and seeing who he is and understanding this mystery and letting it penetrate us to the point where it's no longer us living, it's him living through us. We are in desperate need of that with the church. Amen? When I think of this incredible verse, the revelation or revealing of Jesus Christ, I can't help but think about an incredible scene that took place 2,000 years ago, and you know it, in the temple, right? Where the temple veil was torn. Josephus says it's like 4 inches thick. Incredible. So this veil that separated the holy place where sinful man dwelt and served God, and this holy place where only the presence and Shekinah glory of God dwelt, and there was a separation between the two. But it says when Jesus died, there was an unveiling. There was, are you ready? A revelation. There was a revealing that took place. All of a sudden, these two places where sinful man attempting to know God and serve God in himself and the holiness of God all of a sudden became one room. Whew, I just got goosebumps. Man, that is incredible. That is a revelation, right? Now see, someone who doesn't know God hears that and go, okay. Are we archaeologists here, or what is this? What are we? What's the big deal? Oh, it's a big deal. It's a big deal that that veil was torn like that, because we're able to see something, that revealing, that unveiling, where we go, I'm not separated from God anymore. I'm one with him. And last week we talked about one of the most incredible verses in the Bible in John 17, where Jesus prayed for us. And he said, oh, that they would know that you sent me and that you love them as you've loved me. One and the same. We're one. We're no longer in two places. We're in one. Just the same thing. I've been just chewing on that one all week this week. When I pray, Father, because of the blood and the veil that was torn, I see clearly. When you look at me, you see your son. Death passes by. When I ask in his character, in his name, and we'll get more deeper into that today, when that happens, it's just like Jesus is praying. That's incredible. You made a way, Lord. I want revelation. Don't you want revelation? Some divine, and that's a mystery. How could a holy God dwell not only with, please listen closely, not only with sinful man, you ready? Inside sinful man. The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave to him to show his servants. A revelation was given to Jesus by who? But isn't Jesus God? There's a mystery here. We have a mystery. There's a divine mystery to be unveiled right there. How often we read over things and just pass by, don't we? And we get robbed. Oh, wow, we get robbed. It says that God gave Jesus Christ that came in the flesh. You know John 1:1. In the beginning was the Word, the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The Word came and dwelt in flesh. The Word, deity, Elohim, I mean, this incredible Hebrew word that just speaks, this compound word for God that just tells us that, you know what, do you know God can be at more place one than he can be here, he can be there, he can be in eternity yesterday, tomorrow, he can be in just all these places all at the same time? You know, it's not too difficult for God to be in heaven and God to be on earth at the same time. He's hyperdimensional, if you would. You know, I mean, it's incredible. Some people, well, I don't understand that. Well, do you want to worship a God you can understand? Because if you can, then you might as well worship yourself. If we do, amen. It's the truth. I don't understand this. There's certain things that I see, well, through a glass that's like dim right now, as Paul would say. I don't see it completely right now, but the Lord is making it clear to me that he's a lot bigger than me, a lot smarter than me. And he tells me just enough to know what I need to know for where I'm at right now. And this book right here, this revelation, there's something key for us today that God gave to Jesus. I want you to look with me at Matthew chapter 3, which I think possibly this is what kind of revelation we're talking about that God gave to Jesus. You know the scripture, Matthew 3. It says, verse 13, that Jesus came from Galilee to John at the Jordan and baptized him. And John tried to prevent him, saying, I need to be baptized by you, and you are coming to me? But Jesus answered and said to him, permit it to be so now, for thus it is fitting for us to fulfill all righteousness. And then he allowed him. And when he had been baptized, Jesus came up immediately from the water, and behold, the heavens were opened to him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and alighting upon him. And suddenly a voice came from heaven saying, this is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. Revelation. It just took place. See, we know from the Gospel of Luke, when Jesus was 12, he was growing in wisdom and stature. I mean, he was learning, right? He was learning. There were things he was learning. When he was baptized, I want you to understand that the veil was completely removed to Jesus, the man, to know that he was actually the Messiah. He knew. All of a sudden, this downlook took place where he knew exactly why he was there and who he was. And he began to walk in that fullness of power. God gave this revelation to him. In other words, the flesh that was going to actually die and be resurrected, that didn't define who God was. It was the divine nature of God inside this physical body. That's incredible. I mean, why, God, why would you do that? What's the whole point? I mean, if you're going to save sinful man, why did you do it like that? Why did you take the point where you actually, you're in heaven since you're omnipresent, but you also came down to earth and the Word became flesh. God became a man. And he's and it's something deep for us to look at. We're going, okay, so you're trying to send a message to me. It's a divine mystery how God can be in heaven and yet dwell in flesh. You know, Paul, writing to Timothy, he says something incredible concerning a divine mystery. Listen to this. It says, without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifested in the flesh, justified in the Spirit, seen by angels, preached among Gentiles, believed on the world, received up in glory. Did you hear that? The scripture says there's this great mystery of godliness that, check it out, God was manifested in the flesh. This is this incredible mystery that takes place. Matter of fact, in 1 Timothy 3, where he's talking about leadership in the church, they are to hold the mystery of the faith with a pure conscience. What's the mystery of the faith? We just read it. It's right there. God became a man. He dwelt in flesh. Do you believe that? Can God dwell in flesh? He sure did. He did it through his one and only Son to become the sacrificial lamb for the sin of man, that the veil might be torn. Now, why is that so important today as we think about Jesus coming back and living in the last times? Are you ready? Living in the last days before he comes back, and we see all the things taking place. Why is that supposed to stir our hearts to such a power? Listen to this verse here. This will be our closing verse today. 2 Peter chapter 1, it says, grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. And his divine power has given to us all things that pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of him who called us by glory and virtue, by which have been given to us exceedingly great and precious promises, that through these you may be partakers in the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. Did you hear that? This is a verse that says here, basically, if you're a servant of the Lord, which is, that's who this letter is to. If you want to talk about revelation, divine mysteries, this power bearing witness with the Word of God, being blessed as you hear the Word of God, it says you need to have a partnership, partaking in the divine nature of God. It's like Jesus. You see what Jesus experienced? The Spirit of the living God. And we see this symbol takes place in Matthew 3, where the Spirit of God comes down in the form of a dove and rests upon him. And this Word comes and says, you are my beloved Son. You belong to me. You're mine. We're one. Do you understand this? This oneness. Jesus was big about, I'm one with the Father. The Father and I are one. And I'm praying that you would be one with the Father, like I and the Father are one. That's powerful. Wow. How that's a mystery, though. How could I ever be as close to Papa God, to Abba Father, as Jesus, the Son of God? How could I ever be that close? It's a mystery. Man, it's a divine, divine mystery. Jesus showed, he said, he exemplified it. This is it. I'm coming in flesh as the Son, the first fruits. Man, I'm coming and I'm going to show you the Spirit of God comes to dwell in you and you can walk in holiness and intimacy and oneness with the Father. I'm the prototype. I'm going to lead by example and you follow me. And I'm going to send my Holy Spirit that the same nature, my nature, who I am, can dwell inside you. When that happens, you walk in power. See, if you're a Christian, you're partaking in the divine nature of God, you don't struggle with sin. You don't struggle with sin. If you're struggling with sin, you've forgotten something. Let me tell you what you've forgotten. I don't need to tell you. We can just read. Listen closely, I didn't plan on sharing this, but it's just way too good to not read it to you. In 2 Peter chapter 1, we only read to verse 4 here, but if you look at, it talks about perseverance and self-control and knowledge and brotherly kindness all through verses 5 and 8 and all these incredible fruits that are supposed to take place. And it says in verse 8, for if these things are yours and abound, you will be neither barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. That's a spiritual knowledge. That's a divine revelation that one gets from God, right? It says, for he who lacks these things is short-sighted, even to blindness, and has forgotten that he was cleansed from his old sins. Do you see that? We forgot that spiritual amnesia. I forgot what the blood of the Lamb's done. I forgot that the veil was torn. It's kind of like maybe watching a movie that was a really good mystery, but it's been so many years that you watched it, you're watching it again, and you forgot what happened. We do that with Jesus. There's this incredible mystery that the veil was torn, and holy, sinful man now dwells with God. Deeper than that, God dwells in sinful man. Wow. If you really know that when you blow it and when you do sin and do the wrong thing, you don't feel condemned. You go, I know my dad loves me. I know that when he looks at me, he loves me the same as he loves Jesus because I'm a partaker in the divine nature of God. It's a mystery, 1 Timothy 3:9, but I'm holding fast to this mystery of the faith, this unveiling of who Jesus is and what God showed Jesus, the same thing God is showing me. Do you see this? Now, I know for some of you, this is going zip, and there's some of you going, oh, man, I'm getting that. You've got to chew on this. This is so key. You can't bear witness to the Word of God, as Revelation 1:1-3 talks about, without the Spirit of the living God inside you. You can't have a healthy marriage. You can't have victory over the enemy. When times get tough and the church just starts getting nailed, you're not going to make it. You're not going to make it. When all of a sudden Sharia law pumps into our country and Christians start losing their head because they won't deny Jesus, you'll deny him. If you don't partake in the divine nature of God, you'll find that you had a form of godliness, but you were lacking the power. That's what's going to happen to many Christians in the last days in the church. I say that with a broken heart, man. But that's where we're headed. Oh, but Dave, I've been hearing that for years. Man, wake up. Wake up. Not that I want anyone to become a news junkie in this room, but every now and then, take your head out of the dirt and look around what's going on. See it. It's incredible. I mean, wow, all these prophecies coming to pass. I mean, 5 years ago, we would say, Christians in the last days that won't deny Jesus get their heads taken off. Well, that was probably relevant back then, but not today. Really? Really? And we live in a country that, man, it's in God we trust. Really? We live in Babylon, folks. That's where we live. We live in Babylon, but we're not of Babylon. Hallelujah. We flee Babylon, not so much physically, but spiritually. We are to come out from among them, 2 Timothy 3, right? Those that say, man, I'm about religion, That's just that new age, one world church is just ramping up in the stage being set. Come out from among them. Take a hard line and a hard stand. It's all about Jesus. It's only through the name of Jesus Christ can someone be saved. There's no other way. There's nothing I can do to make myself worthy. He did it on the cross. All I have to do is look to the Father for his love and his gift, and the divine nature comes to live inside me, and I walk in this power. Man, can you imagine if the church would just really grab a hold of this? And no longer are we going to put our hopes in politics or our citizenship on the earth or our intellect or our denomination or our good works or our bank account. That stuff's all going to be stripped. It really will. And you know why? Because God loves us enough to strip us of it. He does. He loves us enough. He cares enough to go, you're trusting in me today, but then yesterday you were trusting in something else, and tomorrow you're like the church of Pergamos. You're polygamous in what you believe and where you stand. The Lord wants to shore us up where when the Son of Man returns, will he find real faith in those that say, see, there are some that are going to go, but Jesus, I went to church and I tithed and I prayed and I prophesied and I prayed in tongues. And he's going, I never knew who you were. Form of godliness, but they didn't have the power. They never got the real revelation of who Jesus is. There was no divine mystery unveiled to them. They didn't understand the torn veil. They didn't understand the whole picture of God coming down in the form of a man and divine nature and power dwelling within him as a message to all that would become sons of God, that in the same way, the nature of God would dwell within them. God did that for us. What an incredible picture. I mean, I want to tap in. That's a revelation I want to tap into, right? I mean, everything flows from that. That's it. Rather than argue about whether tongues is for day or not, or demonology points, or baptism, or election, and all these things that I love to talk about, and I love to dive into God's word. Some of the best advice that a pastor gave to me when I was young, he said, Dave, never take yourself too serious. Boy, I love that advice. I've just found in recent years I'm starting to apply it. Really. I got so busy, oh man, you know, going to Greek 101 and learning this and that and just thinking that I knew something and I don't know anything, okay? I'm an idiot. For real. Anything that good comes out of me is the divine nature of God. Anything that's holy, anything that's really wise, anything that's really powerful, it flows from him. Even Jesus said, I can do nothing outside of the Father. I can't do anything. Now, if Jesus said that, we better be really jumping on that ship, right? I can't do anything without you, Jesus. I can't be holy. I'm unholy. I'm unclean. I can't be a Christian. I need the divine nature of God to dwell within me. And you know how you know when that's really happening? There is an intimacy you have with God that is off the chart. You know what it's like? It's like a voice from heaven saying, you're my son. You're my daughter. I'm well pleased. Pleased with me? Yeah, but it's not based on you that I'm pleased with you, says the Lord. It's just based on the blood that's on that mercy seat. That's all it's based on. Has nothing to do with you. Has everything to do with that sinless, sinless sacrifice that paid the price to remove the consequences that we deserve. We really do. Don't think just because you're not a chainsaw murderer or some type of psychopath that you're a good person. Every person is wicked. Do you know that? Dave, but you don't understand, I'm an American. No, every person is wicked. Well, Dave, no, I'm a Republican. Definitely, every person is wicked, right? Well, David, no, you don't understand. I'm not a man, I'm a woman. Every person is wicked. But we've all got the little things that we compare and we go, well, I'm not as bad as that person. Oh, yes, you are. Sometimes you're even worse because you've got enough of a form of godliness to deceive you. Right? That's why I love going into rehabs, because you talk to some guy who's just destroyed his marriage, his kids. He about killed himself with drugs, and he's desperate. I can't do anything. I can't fix anything. Perfect. perfect. Now you're a vessel that the divine nature of God can come fill in, and now Jesus can walk through you. Now that is what the church is supposed to look like. Amen? That's what we need. So how do we get there, right? Isn't that what you're thinking? Like, well, that sounds awesome. I'm excited. I'm emotionally stimulated a little bit, like far out. You ready? I'm going to tell you what you have to do to walk in this. You ready? The same thing Jesus did. What did he do before that divine nature empowered him and showered him and covered him and that voice came from heaven? He got baptized. I'm not talking about water, folks. I'm talking about what baptism means. Death. Death. What precedes revelation? Well, for John, it was an island called Patmos. How about that? A rock, a prison. Ooh, well, I don't want to go through that to get revelation. Can't he do it in the air conditioning? Can't he do it when in good times? Well, yeah, he'd like to, but we're stubborn and prideful. And so he sends us on a rock. Abraham, before he received revelation of the lamb that to be slain, he first had to go through a mourning of the death of his own son. Even though he reasoned in his mind that God would have to raise the dead, something painful and lost and sacrificial preceded revelation. Do you see what I'm saying? See, if we want if we want to understand this divine nature, that God loves us so much that he actually wants to live inside of us, we have to die first. And there's all kinds of little signs around you saying you're not dead. You're very much alive. Now you see, when the veil was torn, something incredible happened. I wasn't going to read it, but I think I have to read it. Hey, let's read it. What do you say? Matthew chapter 27, verse 50, it says, Jesus cried out again with a loud voice and yielded up his spirit. Then behold, the veil of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. Just real quick, can you imagine this? God being there and just reaching down and just tearing that veil from top to bottom. We serve a big God, amen? So he tears this veil. It says, the earthquake and the rocks were split. And the graves were opened, and many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised. Stephen King has nothing on the Bible. Amen? Amen? Not resident evil, resident holiness. I like that. They were coming out of their graves after his resurrection because he's, the first fruits. It says, they went into the holy city and appeared to many. So when the centurion and those were with him and were guarding Jesus saw the earthquake and the things that had happened, they feared greatly, saying, truly, this was the Son of God. This is what happens, guys. All of a sudden, the veil is torn that we read. The rocks were split. And these people that were dead are now walking around in a glorified power. Do you see what precedes walking in divine nature and power? A death. There's a veil that's torn. God comes in a place where man couldn't be, and man can be in a place where God and he couldn't be, and they come become one. God lives inside them, and that follows a death. After that, you walk in power, just like they did. That's what has to happen. So here's the thing. Pray about this. Lord, how can I die? That's a great question. How can I die? What is it that I'm holding on to? Am I still sitting there, you know, on the ground with my wrench, trying to turn and trying to put this thing together? Maybe it's a matter of just taking that tool and handing it to Dad or dropping it on the floor and saying, I'm done. Maybe that's the death. Maybe it's I'm putting my hope in church, in counseling, in medication, in religion, in my career. Maybe it's codependency with my spouse. And I find, what's the tool that you're holding on to that you think you can fix it? And you lay it down and you go, I need to die. I'm giving it over to you, Lord. I promise when that happens, all of a sudden, this power from within you overflows. Remember last week, our cup overfloweth? You want your cup to runneth over? Die. Be willing to be surrounded by your enemies and feast on only what God gives you and say, okay, Lord, enemies surrounded. I'm going to feast what you've given me, your blood, your cup, and then you fill me, and then I overflow with divine nature. Family, that's the way it works. If you want that today and you want to walk in that power and you're not, be honest enough just to raise your hand right now and say, I'm not there and I want to be today in Jesus' name. Yeah, keep your hand raised high. Now stand to your feet and walk up right here with me. Come stand with me. Amen. Amen. God sees the humble hearts. And we don't need to face the stage. Let's just face our brothers and our sisters coming up here. Those that you did not stand, either you're walking in a wonderful place right now or you're very stubborn, but that's okay because God will get you. He will. By standing right now, I want you to know, guys, this is a point of contact that you're standing here right now. There's no special anointing oil or holy water we're going to spray on you. This is a matter that's just simple. You took a stand today to say, I realize that I'm holding on to my own strength and my own deity, if you would. I'm thinking, I'm God. I can't fix anything. I'm taking a stand today, and I'm asking in Jesus' name. I'm asking, Father, that as I stand here today, that you would empower me with the filling of your Holy Spirit. That in these last days, that you would open my eyes to the nature of the living God dwelling within sinful man. I release my efforts and my own confidence in myself today in Jesus' name. I turn away from every voice that would condemn me. And I receive, Father, by the grace of my King, I receive the gift of freedom to follow Jesus. Your word says, where your spirit is, there's freedom. Freedom dwell in this temple in Jesus' name. I confess today that I believe that the veil is torn. I believe that I have fellowship with you. I welcome you, Holy Spirit, to come and deliver me from every bitter root. If there's unforgiveness in my life today, I call that down. I forgive all those that would sin against me and have hurt me. I lay that at your feet, Lord. I forgive them by the power of your Holy Spirit. Father, where there's sin, I repent today. Where there's compromise, I repent today. I turn to you, Father God, with all of my heart. As I stand in your presence, I pray, God, that your spirit would fall upon me. Open my eyes to my adoption. Open my eyes, Father God, that you've removed my sin. I've forgotten, God, that you've forgiven me of everything. Today, I bless you with all of my soul, God, because you have forgiven all of my sin. You've healed all of my diseases. Father, I leave this world behind and follow after you. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 Have a seat, guys. Have a seat. God bless you. Amen. Now, for those of you that walked forward, this is what I want you to do. I want you to find yourself, maybe Karen would help. I don't know if we have enough, but we'll see what we have enough. I want you to get a communion cup. If you are, you can use something at your house. And every day this week, when you get up in the morning, get up a half an hour earlier and go have communion. Do it. Go have communion. Get up in the morning and say, I am just calling down any relapses of spiritual amnesia in my life, Lord. I am focusing, I'm feasting at your table in the midst of a dark world about what you did on the cross for me. I'm taking that in deeper than I ever have before because I believe as I take in this, you live inside me, Lord. Because of the blood, because of the body of Christ, you live inside me. Do that every morning for a week this week, will you? Just get up early. Half an hour early, spend some time with him, have communion. Allow the Spirit of God to overflow where you weep with a vision of Christ on the cross. Seriously, Ask God, Lord, show me, reveal to me, remove any veil. I want to go deeper to see how big you are, how amazing you are, how big your love is. Take me deeper, and as I hold this cup, may it be more than just tradition, Lord, our habit. May it break my heart, God. May it fill me with joy, Father. Do that this week. Go deeper in him. May God reveal to us divine mysteries through the divine nature of God that lives inside of us. To this we were called throughout eternity. Amen. Let's stand. Father, we thank you so much for the gift of your one and only Son, Jesus. We thank you for the revelation, the revealing that you have removed the veil to open the eyes of the blind, to cause the deaf to hear what the Spirit would say to the church, the lame to leap for joy. Father God, we ask as we would venture on this next 10, 11 weeks through this study, we ask God that you would transform our lives. Father God, empower us in these last days to not settle for 30 or 60, but 100-fold of your blessing in these last days. We pray your blessing on the body that's about to walk in the next service. Lord, may you just encounter them. Lord, may you just overtake them with a wave of your presence. Even as they walk through the door, we pray blessing on them, Lord. Continue to pour out revival in these last days. God, we need you. We're desperate for you. All we need is you. All we need is you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.